the hardest thing to give away, the last thing on your mind today. It always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel, and the pain they cause is just too real. Takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. Forgiveness. It flies on the face of all your pride. It moves away the mad inside. It's always anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge, it's a whisper in your ear saying, set it free. Forgiveness. 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 Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Help me now to do the impossible. Set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness, I want to finally set it free. So show me how to see what your mercy sees. Help me now to give what you gave to me. Forgiveness. Oh, forgiveness. Forgiveness.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to St. Mark's. Today is the fourth Sunday in Lent. A number of announcements after worship today is Sunday school and confirmation. This Thursday, I will be away. I'm going to be at what's called a Chrism Mass. And you're probably wondering what a Chrism Mass is. Chrism is oils that are blessed by our bishop, and oils that are used in baptism, healing rites, forgiveness, last rites, things like that. So it's a tradition to get new oils every year, and we haven't done it in Nebraska for a while. They have different locations, so this Thursday I will be at Pierce for that. And it's also an opportunity for us that are ordained to renew our ordination vows, which works out really well because if you see, I was installed 6 years ago tomorrow. That's me and Mom and Dad up there. Recognize that velvet curtain? I don't. Let's see what else is happening. Saturday is the mobile food pantry. Technically, it is First Trinity's and the Methodist Church's turn. But since I'm the only clergy in town, I will be there. But if anyone wants to help, we will never turn away help at the mobile food pantry. Be there by 11:30 if you would like to help take care of things there. Next Sunday is our council meeting. We have sign-ups in the back for Holy Week worship for the 3 days, Thursday, Friday, and Easter Sunday. I'm going to be looking for three lectors for Good Friday. I want to do something a little bit different this year. So if there can be three lectors, three people that can help with reading, please sign up for that. And also keep in mind, Easter flowers. I like all kinds of flowers for Easter. Do you know when Easter is? March 31st. So it's coming up soon, believe it or not. And then the other picture up there, we had 85 people for dinner church this week. It was getting a little scary because people kept coming and kept coming and kept coming and kept coming. But it was amazing. So this week we will be at the Methodist Church. So let's kind of keep that momentum going. It was a really great evening with the Verdigre Men's Chorus. So thank you, Laurel, for bringing the guys in for some music that night. That was really, really appreciated. I think that's it for announcements. Does anybody have anything that they would like to share with the group?
Thanks to Alexander.
What was that?
Oh, and
thank you, Alexander, for singing. If you can stand for our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Held in God's mercy, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy God, we confess that we are caught in snares of sin and cannot break free. We hoard resources while our neighbors are hungry and cold. We speak in ways that silence others. We are silent when we should speak up. We keep score in our hearts. We let hurts grow into hatred. For all these things, and for sins only you know, forgive us, Lord. Amen. Here is a flood of grace. Out of love for the whole world, God draws near to us, breaks every snare of sin, washes away our wrongs, and restores the promise of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Oh, I have the wrong number. No, that's right, 178. Only by grace we can enter. Yeah. Oh. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the reign of God and for peace throughout the world, for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For your people here who have come to give you praise, for the strength to live your word, let us pray to the Lord. Save and defend us, O God. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, rich in mercy, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world and rescued us from the hopelessness of death. Lead us into your light, that all our deeds may reflect your love, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
Good morning.
Morning.
Our first lesson is taken from Numbers chapter 21, a reading from Numbers. From the Mount of Or, the Israelites set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom, but the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people, and they bit the people, so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on the pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole. And whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is from Psalm 107. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good, for God's mercy endures forever.
Let the redeemed of the Lord proclaim that God redeemed them from the hand of the foe.
Gathering them in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south.
Some were fools and took rebellious paths. With their sins they were afflicted.
They loathed all manner of food and drew near to death's door.
Then in their trouble they cried to the Lord, and you delivered them from their distress.
You sent forth your word and healed them and rescued them from the grave.
Let them give thanks to you, Lord, for your steadfast love and your wonderful works for all people.
Let them offer sacrifices of thanksgiving and tell of your deeds with shouts of joy. Our second lesson is from Ephesians, a reading from Ephesians. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passion of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places of Christ Jesus, so that in all ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Now the results of work, so that no one may boast, for we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave us his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people loved darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated, and if the kids can come up. Go ahead, Laurel. You know this song? What's this song called? What was that? This Little Light of Mine. Let's all sing it. You too. And clap along if you'd like. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. So when you are at home and you go into a dark room, Wesley, what do you do when you go into a dark room? What do you need to turn on? A light. Why do you have to turn on a light? So you can see. What happens if you go into a room that's dark and you can't see? What could happen? You could crash into stuff, right? Especially in the middle of the night when you have to go to the bathroom. How many of us have stubbed our toe on the bed? How many of us have said words after that? Right? You have to turn on the light so you can see, so you don't get hurt. God gives us a light to see when things seem dark. And that light is Jesus. He's our light to help us see that God forgives, that God loves, and that God saves. And you can also be that light. Did you know that? You can be God's love in the world. You can be friends to people that need friends, because sometimes they feel like they're in the darkness too. So God sent us Jesus to be the light in the world. So let's stand up. Let's stand in a circle. And we're going to sing This Little Light of Mine. We're going to sing a bunch of verses. So are you ready, Laurel? Come on, clap, clap. No. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine. Everywhere I go, everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine. Jesus gave it to me. Jesus gave it to me. I'm gonna let it shine. Jesus gave it to me, I'm gonna let it shine. Jesus gave it to me, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. And the people said, Amen. Have a seat. I made them do stuff today. So grace to you and peace from God, our Creator, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, our first reading from the Old Testament book of Numbers, it's really interesting and a bit puzzling. So Israel had been liberated from slavery in Egypt. And no sooner they were out and on their way to the promised land, they started complaining or murmuring, as some Bible translations put it. So here's some highlights. Why didn't God let us die in comfort? Die in comfort? It's more comfortable to be a slave in Egypt, where we had lamb stew and all the bread we could eat. You brought us out to this wilderness to starve us to death, the whole company of Israel. Why can't we have meat? We ate fish in Egypt and got it free. And to say nothing of the cucumbers and melons and the leeks and onions and garlic, nothing tastes good out here. All we get is manna, manna, manna. Reminds me when I was a kid. Mom, why do we always have to have potatoes for supper? Because your sister needs them. I love potatoes now. We wish we died with the rest of our brothers who died before God. Why did you haul this congregation of God out here in the wilderness to die? The people and the cattle alike. Why did you take us out of Egypt in the first place, dragging us into this miserable country? No grain, no figs, no grapevines, no pomegranates, and now no water. I mean, this constant complaining came to a head with disastrous results in chapter 21 of Numbers. A Canaanite king heard Israel was advancing up the road, and the Canaanites attacked and took several prisoners of war. And Israel cried out for strength in defeating the Canaanite king and his kingdom, which they did. And no sooner after their victory, they went back to complaining. Why did you drag us out in Egypt to die in this God-forsaken country? No decent food, no water. We can't stomach this stuff any longer. And God had enough. Parents, have you ever said that? I have had enough. And drastic measures are taken. Am I correct? Now, you probably didn't do what God did and sent poisonous snakes, but maybe inside you were thinking that's not such a bad idea. Poisonous snakes, they bite, they kill. And what point was God making by sending poisonous snakes? And all along, the issue had been trust. People do not trust that God and God's agent Moses will provide, protect, and guide them. Moses did not challenge the people to believe in some doctrine sent by God. Instead, Moses tried to lead the people forward into trusting God. The people rebel against God. They question God's plan. They wonder if God had their best interests in mind. They don't have faith, they do not trust. And if the people do not trust God, how can they trust each other? There are consequences for the people's lack of trust. Snakes. Poisonous snakes. Remember Indiana Jones? Gets into the pit and what does he see? What's the one thing he's afraid of? Snakes. I mean, it makes my skin almost as bad as bats and spiders. I mean, snakes are coming out of nowhere, crawling and slithering around your feet, biting and killing. You come to your senses very quickly. And Israel realizes their lack of trust in God and Moses' leadership. And they ask Moses to ask God to take the snakes away. God tells Moses to make a serpent out of bronze and put it on a pole. Anyone who has been bitten shall look upon it and live. Can you imagine if you went to the doctor and Dr. Riley said, look at this brass or this bronze snake and you'll live? Isn't that magic or idolatry? I mean, both are forbidden by God. Yet this bronze snake will save them? Here one needs to trust in God's plan of salvation. An inanimate object cannot save, but God saves. It's not about the snake, it's about God. God is telling Israel to look upon what killed them. They reflect on why the snakes came and how their actions brought dissension into the community and ate away at their relationship with God and with each other. Look at that snake and know your sin. Look at that snake and return to God. Professor of religion Barbara Brown Taylor writes this, looking up at it, they looked th- through it to see their only physician, who alone was their health, their salvation, and their cure. Now, why does Jesus, in our gospel reading, bring this up to the Pharisee Nicodemus? Jesus says, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. And again, it's about trust. Now, in the original Greek, I love my Greek. The word translated as believe is pisteuon, which can be translated as to place confidence in, to trust. If you believe, place your confidence, your trust in Christ, you will live. So let's reread our gospel, replacing believe with trust. Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, and whoever trusts him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who trusts him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who trust him are not condemned, but those who do not trust are condemned already, because they do not trust in the name of the only Son of God. Trusting is pretty risky. Have you ever had someone say to you, trust me, and they end up not being trustworthy? Or have you ever tried to convince someone to trust you, and they couldn't be convinced even though you could have been trusted? Trust involves surrender, and surrender involves love. Now later on in John, after Jesus washes the feet of his disciples, he commands his disciples to love. I give you a new commandment that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. I mean, everyone believes it's good to love your neighbor. It's easy to love your neighbor when they're like-minded neighbors. They have the same political leanings, they're church-going Christians, born in the USA, speak English, have a job, maybe married like you. But what if they don't fall into those categories? Often those outside of the circles are left to fend for themselves. Will they trust you will love them as Christ loves them? Will you trust Christ's love for all? Because remember, for God so loved the world. Jesus brings up Moses and the snake in his conversation with Nicodemus because of the darkness of the world. Darkness and evil and sin and mistrust. Misplaced trust has poisoned God's creation. God's mission of love in Christ crucified is to mend creation, not condemn it, but mend it. God's idea of mending through Christ crucified will take more than just believing God will mend it. It's trusting that God is mending creation through Christ crucified. Do you trust in God's plan to mend all creation in Christ crucified? Amen.
Thank you.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world definitely in need. Gracious God, your love unites. Give vision to the global church and foster cooperation in mission. Increase interreligious understanding, ecumenical dialogue. Make your church a sanctuary for all fleeing persecution, disaster, and war, especially Israel, Gaza, and Ukraine. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating God, your love enlivens. Restore balance to the earth's fragile habitats. Preserve wilderness lands, rainforests, farmlands, and wildlife. Cleanse oceans and rivers. Make us good stewards of the earth. Hear us, O God.
Mercy is great.
Righteous God, your love liberates. We give thanks for those who courageously witness to your liberating love. Free all people from the evils of racism, religious strife, and hatred. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Merciful God, your love heals. Care tenderly for all those who loved ones perished from pandemic disease in every nation. Strengthen healthcare workers, first responders, and caregivers. Relieve all who live with chronic illness and pain. We lift up the names for whom we pray. Vicki Achenbach.
Vicki.
Sue Achenbach.
Sue.
Ruth Ann Grimm.
Ruth Ann.
Jean Schroeder.
Jean.
Patrick Kester.
Patrick.
Bill Sasma.
Bill.
Laura Gieselman.
Laura.
Fern Schlottman.
Fern.
And Tom Trenhale.
Tom.
Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Incarnate God, your love enlightens. Open our hearts and minds to fresh understandings of our faith. Deepen our love for you and for one another. Teach us to pray for our enemies. Help us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Living God, your love brought us to this life. May you continue to bring your love to those celebrating birthdays this week, especially Yvonne Bronsworth,
Yvonne,
Andy Goebbels,
Andy,
Derek Friedrichsen,
Derek,
Andrew Hunhoff,
Andrew,
Rowan Goebbels,
Rowan,
Julie Broders,
Judy,
Logan Dorr,
Logan,
Becky Rowley,
Becky,
and Alexander Grimm.
Alexander.
Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Abiding God, your love saves. Those who died in the faith are made alive in Christ. We give thanks for your promise that we also will be raised to newness of life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you. Share a sign of peace with those around you.
I'm having a hard time hearing stuff because my right hearing aid burned out. So I still got some coming in the left, so we'll see.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ, and praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took a cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. And Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated. This is bread for the journey, a feast for hungry hearts. Come to the table, for it is now ready. Please stand if you're able. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you, preserve you, and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Let us pray. Generous God, at this table, we have tasted your immeasurable grace. As grains of wheat are gathered into one bread, now make us one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life. Amen. Beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, and renewed. God bless you and keep you, shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace. Amen.
Catch the sweet though far off hymn that hails a new creation. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since God is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? Through all the tumult and the I hear that music ringing. It finds an echo in my soul. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? What though my joys and comforts lie, the Lord my Savior liveth. What though the darkness gather round, songs in the light he giveth. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since Christ is Lord of heaven and keep on singing. The peace of Christ makes flush my heart, a fountain ever springing. All things are mine since I am his. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing?
So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Morning. Morning. Good to see you again.